Welcome everybody. Today's session is on the adolescent brain and looking at the implications of understanding the adolescent brain, what that means for you as a teacher in junior secondary and working with students. But today I'm going to make you work. So the first thing we're going to do, you're going to see activity shots right through this. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to do a mind map. Now I'm going to ask you to take a piece of white paper from the centre of the table each. There's some coloured pens there for you to work with. And I want you to use your mind map as a note-taking system this morning. So as I start to talk to you about the adolescent brain, what I want you to do is in the centre of that piece of paper, write the adolescent brain. And then as I talk to you, use different colours and start to take notes about what we're doing. Now, you'll also notice that on the table, I've put a handout for you. Now, that handout has got each of the activities that we'll do today in there. It'll give you an explanation about the activity, how you can use it in your classroom, the advantages of using it, and why it's important as a cognitive tool for use with young adolescents. So in terms of a mind map, we know it's a great graphic organiser. It's a way to actually put your ideas, brainstorm, to collect notes. It's quite systematic and actually works the way that our brain works. And also it's a great way of working collaboratively and then building on. I've actually used mind maps as a form of assessment when I've had students here at university looking at some syllabus documents, and I've actually got them to create a mind map of what they understand, and it was the syllabus at that point in time to do, and then demonstrate the interrelationships between each of the areas and points that they'd put down. And it was a very, very effective way of assessing student learning. So what I want you to do now is to work on that, and so we'll head on through. So the first thing that we know about the brain at this point in time is that 93% of the human brain has been actually developed by the age of six. So there's a huge amount of brain growth that happens in very early infancy, and then the next major brain spurt happens in early adolescence. And so at this point in time, their brains are really active and really growing and doing a lot of reconfiguring. We also know that this wave has implications in the classroom in terms of the different things that are happening at this point in time. Because what we know is that their brain actually grows and develops from the bottom up and inside out. Now, at the base of the brain, we have the cerebellum. Now, the cerebellum is responsible for gross motor skills, for breathing, and a lot of those involuntary things that just happen. And so we basically know if they're a warm body in the room and breathing, that their cerebellum is doing pretty well. So we'll go from there. The other thing that we know now, and it's because of technology and the fact that we've had MRIs and these sorts of things, we've been able to actually film and assess and explore and evaluate what's happening in the brain on live specimens, because before all we had was autopsied brains to work with. And so it's given us a huge insight over the last probably 20 or so years into what's actually happening in the brain at particular points in time. And what we now understand is that the brain is actually a lot more flexible and plastic and malleable than we once thought. We used to think that they would get to a certain point and what was there was fixed and that we actually couldn't do a lot with it. But we now know that we can, that there's a lot more right into adulthood. And so if you're thinking at this point in time, well, I'm past it, things are difficult to learn, there's a reason for that, but it doesn't mean you can't. And so we understand that from brain development. So if you have a look at this here, and it's a continuum from 5 to 20, if you put in the centre at the age of about 10 or 11, you can see that this is the activity in the brain and it's the brain reconfiguring and working. And what you see is there's a huge amount happening. And around that 10, 11 age, there's a huge amount of still really active brain matter working as they're filmed. And then when you get to probably the next set, which is about 15, 16, there's a lot less, and you can see then at 20, there's very little that's still working. There's still parts of the brain that are developing and maturing up till about 25. So if you're sitting next to somebody who's under 25, take any sharp objects away from them because they're still probably not quite there. You can't trust them with it. But we know that this is what's happening in our young adolescents, and it has incredible implications for you as a teacher, because the use it or lose it principle really applies at this point. What we actually get them to do and the things that we practice and work with will be the things that they will actually hardwire their brain to do really effectively. So what we know is that there's a proliferation of neural connections followed by pruning. So what the brain does is it actually explodes in terms of building, developing all these neurons in the brain. And then what it says is, okay, well, these ones we're going to pull back on. And it's this trying to create an efficiency in the brain in terms of these are the ones that are working really well, and these are the ones that we're actually going to stop using. And it's a little bit like a road network in your brain. And if you can imagine the government looking at our road networks and saying, well, I've got this beautiful 8-lane highway heading down to the Gold Coast, but nobody's really using it. So what I'm actually going to do is I'm going to lift it and put it out to Toowoomba because everybody's going west. There's a gold rush and we're all heading west. But what they do then is you say, well, if you've moved that, can we still get to the Gold Coast? And absolutely you can. You can go out through Koonunga and you can go down through Beaudesert and you can go different ways. Is it as efficient? No, but you can still do it. And that's what the brain is actually doing. It's lifting and making these super highways between parts of the brain to create easy access to information and to skills and processes. Now, the growth spurts in the brain also align with different milestones and different things that are happening at this point in time. And so we have the onset of adolescence. And it's quite interesting when you think about early early childhood, and we have that growth brain spurt, and which is triggered a lot by hormones at that point in time. Then we have it again when we get those hormones kicking in again at about 10, 11. So from about the years of 4 to about 9, 10, 11, what we find is that the brain is pretty stable and pretty, you know, there's a lot of skills that they're learning, but it doesn't really burst into this great developmental stage until the puberty starts to kick in. So I just want to show you a short video about how our brain works and then work from there. I think there's a couple of things there that I'd like to explain. First of all is when we make those connections and close those gaps, we actually don't actually close those gaps, but what the brain does is it wraps a thing called myelin around those connections to actually stabilise them, to make them more solid. And the other thing that's really quite interesting is you could see that the first time you crossed over, they'd done it once. And it was tough and they got there, but they actually had to keep doing it a number of times before they got really, it was very easy, and they actually had to keep stabilising and putting more and more supports in there. And that has implications for you to understand for your teaching, because just because a child has done something once and it was a struggle and it's a bit of a yahoo moment, what happens though is they actually need to be able to repeat that process before they move on and start using that that crossing, for example, to start carrying things across. So what we need to do is ensure that we actually get that automaticity going when we're teaching new skills, so that we give lots of opportunities to practice and to reinforce the learning, so that we actually make sure that those connections are really well established. And so whatever we focus on building those connections to do is what students will become very proficient at. So for example, if we do a lot of problem solving and we do a lot of mental activities and really higher order thinking tasks, students will begin to be hardwired and become very, very good at problem solving and critical thinking and doing those higher order thinking tasks. If we get them to sit and be quite passive note takers, that's what they'll actually be able to do. They'll be able to sit well and be passive note takers. And so we need to consider what you're doing within the classroom to actually build those connections. So the implications for you are, what connections do I want my students to be able to build in their brain at this point in time? Okay. So there's a couple of areas of the brain that I actually want to talk about. The first is the corpus callosum. Now the corpus callosum is like a tissue area that joins both sides of the brain. And so it's involved in, it really strengthens at this point in time, and it helps students in terms of their creativity. It helps them coordinate their movement. It helps them to process really complex information as it gets both hemispheres of the brain talking more efficiently and effectively. And girls actually have a larger corpus callosum than boys. So there are things that are have a biological underpinning when we look at the difference between the genders. So there are things that girls have different in the brain to boys and vice versa. And so there is a biological underpinning for a lot of what's happening during adolescence as well. And it grows and starts to grow before puberty, but certainly speeds up during that time. Now, this is probably the part of the brain that I think is the most important for you to understand. Now, as I said before, that the brain develops from the bottom up, inside out. Now, just above the cerebellum is what we know as the limbic system. Now, the limbic system is the emotional centre of the brain. And from the age, it's very heightened during early childhood, and that's why we experience things like the terrible twos. And it's because their first response to everything is through that emotional filter of the brain. It hits and they explode because that's what's happening. And then it sort of goes into hibernation from about 4 to about 10 or 11. And all of a sudden the hormones start to kick in as puberty starts to hit. And guess what? The limbic system again is incredibly heightened, and most of what happens and most of what a young adolescent starts to respond to is through that limbic system. So if something happens, you will see these really heightened emotions and really over the top sometimes responses to things that seem to be quite insignificant to you. The other thing that's really important about the limbic system is it's also very strongly connected to the emotional, but to the long-term memory. Now, if you can think about your earliest memories or a number of significant memories that you have, more often than not, they are attached to an emotion. Now, it might be a time that you were very, very happy. It might be a time that you were very, very frightened. It might be some time that you were very hurt or emotional in terms of being sad. But our memories, our long-term memory, is often attached to emotion. So what does that tell you in terms of implications for what you're doing in a classroom? Do we need to beat them up and make them really unhappy in there? Are they going to remember that? Making them emotional. What we need, humour is a really important part of teaching and effective teaching in these junior secondary years. If you can develop a connection with you, if they have an emotional connection, like a relationship with you, and you're using humour and they're enjoying it, they will remember what you're doing. And so that's a really important part of the understanding what's happening in their brain at this point in time. The other thing is that the structural changes in their limbic system happen well into adolescence, but it, as a part of the brain, matures a lot earlier than the prefrontal cortex or the frontal lobes, which is the decision-making part of the brain. And it is involved in organising, in rational thought, and it's like the brakes of the brain that sort of tell you. So the limbic system is the part of the brain that says, going down a really steep hill blindfolded on an electric skateboard is a really great idea. And the frontal lobes of the brain are the part that says, actually, maybe not. But what happens is that the limbic system and that has already told them that that's a great idea, and so they're off and running. And it's not until they crash and burn and have bark off all over the place that they think, maybe that wasn't such a great idea. So what we need to do is recognise that this part of the brain is taking a long time to reconfigure. It's the front of the brain. It's the last part to really solidify and get in order. And for most people, and particularly males, so females actually mature and their brain matures a little bit earlier. For males, it's about 25 before we can say that, you know, hopefully, oh no, there were some laughs there. Hopefully their brain is actually there. And so you actually have this fight between the limbic system and the prefrontal lobe. So the limbic system is going, you know, let's do it, let's do it, let's do it, let's, you know, be quite impulsive. And the frontal lobes, that rational thought, is thinking, oh, maybe not. And so you've got this argument. And the limbic system often wins out. And so, and it's responsible for those young people when you say, what on earth were you thinking when you did that? And you know, the fact is that they weren't, because it was an emotional response that they're going through. And it's the same when you get a child that will come up to you or a student come up to you that something's happened in the playground or whatever, and they're exploding at you. You know, it's not that the frontal lobes can't work, it's just that they need a minute to kick in. And so all you've got to do is say, stop right there, take a minute, and it will be enough for them to slow down and to actually engage the part of their brain that actually needs to be working. So challenges in the executive function, which is our frontal lobes, is that they will actually have difficulty planning a project because their sense of time is quite distorted. And so the implications for you in terms of that is that you need to be doing some scaffolding in terms of time audits and helping them to recognise when they need to have bits and pieces done. So giving them a project week one, term one, and expecting this great big product week nine, term one, without any sort of checkpoints along the way, probably you're going to have very few students complete that or complete it to a standard or to the standard that they potentially could, because they do. They will definitely have problems comprehending how long a project does, and I don't think any of us ever grow out of that. They'll struggle to tell a story verbally or in written form because they find it difficult to work through it in a linear fashion, because that's the prefrontal lobe's job, is to work through things in a linear fashion, and quite often the limbic system is all over the shop. And that's why something like a graphic organiser such as a mind map is really good, because what you can do is get them to get everything down on paper and then start numbering things and then start writing and working through. So using strategies like that to help them actually organise themselves is really, really helpful. They will definitely have trouble explaining things in an organised manner for that same reason. And they will also have difficulty with mental strategies to memorise or recall information. And so you've got to actually work quite cleverly in terms of helping them to understand information and giving them ways to do it, and whether that be through humour or different things. I'm actually learning sign language with my husband at the moment, and it's really quite difficult, but the teachers, and one of the things that she does is she actually tries to attach words or symbols with something that's quite funny. And the word for the symbol for want is like that, and don't want is like that. And she said, you know, if you want something, you're going to swallow it, and if you don't want it, you're going to bring it up. Okay. See if you remember that in a couple of days, you probably will. But they're the sorts of things that you need to try and do. You need to try and make connections for students in terms of the work, and it's that relevance to the outside world and what makes meaning for them in terms of the way that you're going to do it. Now, they also will struggle to start working independently or initiating ideas independently. And so they actually need prompts and ways to get going. And so you need a lot of things to stimulate and to actually help them generate ideas. Okay, so characteristics of the adolescent brain then, in terms of what it means for you as a teacher, is that they're more prone to risk taking due to their lesser ability to resist those impulses. That's not to say that they can't, and it's also not to say that you need to condone or accept inappropriate behaviour. What you need to be able to do is to help them recognise and work out ways to control that. And so it might be a symbol or a way that you do that, but helping them to understand that that's the way it goes. They have an undeveloped ability to take moral responsibility. At this point in time, their sense of, they're very egocentric, and their sense of moral responsibility is quite out the window in terms of risk taking. So they will take a lot of risks in relation to sex, drugs, alcohol, tobacco, all those sorts of things, because they don't see the consequences and don't even consider the consequences, because their concept of time is quite distorted, and that limbic system is really telling them that that instant gratification is what they're after, that emotional rush. And that's one of the reasons why young people in a car, they're under a lot more pressure, and peer pressure is so relevant at this point in time too, because they are more likely to do something very impulsive that is inappropriate when they've got an audience of their peers. And so working through those sorts of things is also quite a challenge, because their peers are very important to them at this point in time as well. Those relationships are very strong. So they're they're often less able to understand and to recognise what the consequences would be for actions. And a lot of times, because that concept of time is so difficult, they really don't care either, because they think, well, that's a long time away. That really doesn't work. So in terms of intellectual development, we know that they prefer active learning over passive learning. So if they're actively doing something, either they're very curious, they need it to be related to them and to be connected to their world, and it will create meaning for them and engagement. They also need adult approval. So we often think that they're very tight with their peers, but they are modelling and they are watching adult behaviour because they're looking to try and establish their sense of identity and who they are. And they're looking at doing that through modelling what adults do and what you do as a significant adult in their life. Okay. So this brings us to another point too, is as their brain is developing, they're developing what we call metacognition, and they're also developing that sense and moving from that concrete operational thought into more abstract thought. Now, when you get these young people in year seven, quite a number of them still won't be in that abstract operational thought point, and they will flux back and forth. So one day they will be able to think abstractly really well and do some things like algebra and different things where they have symbolic representations and be able to take an opposing view to their personal belief, but the next day they won't. And you'll watch, it'll almost be like these aha moments that you'll experience through the year as their brain develops. So you will see them actually doing that. So it's really important that you use a lot of concrete materials where you can, because it helps to solidify it. It is important as well for those who are already able to do that abstract thinking, but for those who are still moving from that concrete operational into that abstract thinking, it's really supports and helps them. But at that point, when they're starting to think more abstractly, it's almost, and I like to explain it, almost like having an out-of-body experience, because what they do is they seem to be able to put themselves here and look, and they look at themselves and try and imagine think that other people are just looking at every point of them and being quite critical of them. And so they become very self-conscious, and there's this sense of social anxiety around. And that's why you'll often see them trying to fit in by wearing the same things and doing the same things with other people, because they're trying to fit in to that social group. And they've got that very increased social self-consciousness and are very vulnerable to criticism about how they look and what they think in terms of that. So what does all this mean now for you as a teacher? It means that you need to consider the types of activities that you're doing within your classroom. What are the implications for you in terms of, or what are you already doing with your students in there to actually consider and to take into consideration the fact that their limbic system is very heightened and their prefrontal cortex, or that executive functioning part of their brain, is actually a little bit slower? What sort of things can you be putting in there to help scaffold and support that growth? What do you need to be explicitly teaching? And there's a range of things. If we know that their moral development is actually a little bit underdeveloped at this point, you might need to be doing quite a bit of social skilling. And we know that, because a lack of social skills is actually a significant barrier to learning. And so we need to actually be working through that. And what areas of presentation in terms of what you're doing in your classroom, do you need to be more mindful of? And one of the things that you need to be more mindful of is the fact that your facial and your physical gestures actually match in terms of what you're saying. Because a young adolescent can only read correctly about 50% of your facial expression, whereas an adult can read 100% generally. And so you can be looking quite excited about something, and they'll think that you're angry, and they'll look at you. And I had an experience where I was in a library and walked through, and there were a group of girls who were group of year nine girls who were sitting there working really well, and I smiled at them, went and got something from the librarian's office and walked back, and one of the girls asked me, do we need to leave the library, miss? And I said no, and she said, well, you looked really angry. And I said, I was really pleased that you were working so well together. It was nice to see. And I probably should have stopped and said something and complimented them, said, you know, it was nice to see you working well. But I had it completely misread my facial expression. And so be very aware that what you say and the way that you act all match, because they will misread those cues. Okay, we're going to move on to the next activity now. So if you flip over your in your page, not your mind map, you've got your mind map sitting there. How are your mind maps looking, by the way? Got some quite colourful ones, some are quite full. How did you find that as a note-taking? good? Okay. So the next activity we're going to do is a thing called two questions. And so what I want you to do is to work in your groups, and I want you to do a thing individually and then to share, is to think about two questions is a reflective activity, and what it does is it usually use it after a lesson, you can use it after a unit, or you can actually use it after they've done a particular task or an assignment and they've gotten feedback from it. So what I want you to do is to have a look at your mind map in terms of your understanding about the young adolescent brain, what we've talked about already, and I want you to consider, okay, what am I doing well to cater for a young adolescent in terms of their brain development in my classes? And then the second question that you need to ask is, how can I improve? What things can I be different, do differently? So if you were getting students at the end of a lesson or end of an activity or unit, you can say, you know, what did you do well? Or what did we do well as a class? How did that go really well? So that's your first question. And the second question is, what could we do to improve? And so you're using that metacognition, that reflecting. They've got to analyse and they've got to critically consider what has actually happened to be able to respond to both of those questions. So as a cognitive tool, it's actually quite powerful. So I'll give you a couple of minutes just to make some notes about what you think you're doing well in your classroom to help cater for the young adolescent brain, and then have a look at what things you think you can improve on, and we'll do a little bit of sharing. So I'll give you about 2 minutes to work on that. Okay, let's do some sharing. So tell me some of the great things that you're doing in your classroom to cater for the young adolescent brain, the developing brain at this point. What are some of the things that you think you're doing well, or that you know that you're doing well? Somebody happy to share? Great.
Well, we scaffold, and we came up with, we also use a lot of visual prompts with word walls, and we also explicitly teach. So we chunk the lesson into different components,
yep,
where we actually tell them what we're going to do, show them, then they have a go, and then they move on to, you know, working. So there's clarification during all of that. And also we implement the social skills with our expectations and school-wide positive behaviour programs. And then we've got our what you already know, how you're going to learn.
So that goal setting, we're actually going to do that a little bit later on. Great. So you're doing lots of really, really great things. So it's affirming, isn't it, to know, you know, I'm on the right track, we're doing some great stuff. Anybody else doing anything different to add to that?
I work at a flexible learning school called Arethusa College, so I work with a lot of boys aged between 12 and 20. We have a girls program as well. So we found with the boys it's best to do short bursts of activities, like half an hour of English. Then we go downstairs to the gym and do a physical activity, making sure they've had something to eat, those sort of things.
Yep.
Because we're catering for a lot of kids with special needs and might be in care, all the stuff going on at home, so.
Great.
So we pick our battles, so sometimes you overlook the swearing and stuff a bit, and occasionally you just go, oh, that's enough of the language, and then.
Yeah, and that's the thing, is it's just that stop.
Yeah.
And it's really important, because as a teacher teaching in junior secondary, you can really escalate behaviour really quickly, because the minute you start reacting to behaviour that's inappropriate, in a way, you know, without being calm, you actually can escalate that behaviour quite quickly. So, you know, that's really important that we do that.
Just building on that, I've started with my year sevens to do morning fitness, so the first half an hour of the day, because a lot of the PD I went to talked about how the sleep cycle doesn't finish till about 10 o'clock, and I've found that it allows for greater attention throughout the day, so the final session is a lot more productive than what it was before I started doing that stuff.
Absolutely. Great. Okay. Are there some things that you've that have been talked about today that you're thinking, okay, I need to consider that. I hadn't considered that before. Anybody want to share? Anybody?
Our school has for their sixes and sevens, has a point system, accrue to camp or to Wet n Wild at the end of the year or whatever. And the kids have to achieve so many points by doing the basics, or if they achieve too many detentions, they are ultimately excluded from the opportunity. Looking at that, that they can't make that link. If I stuff up here, that's the end result. They can't see that consequence in the short term, and just, I guess, for us to have a look at that and rework it, because it's not realistic with their own brain function to make that, I better stop this because at the end of the year I'll miss out on this. Yeah, that's something
so for short, us to really take back. Yep, shorter consequences along the way are really important. So as we move on now, what we're going to have a look at this next session is looking at student motivation and engagement. So we're starting to understand a little bit about the brain. We're starting to understand a little bit about the adolescent learner in terms of what that means for us. So how do we actually engage and motivate and get these young people to be working within our classrooms? So we know that the onset of puberty means a number of things and changes in them. It's not just brain, it's their physical changes and it's their social and emotional changes. And so physically as well, they're going through a lot of change. And that's one of the reasons why these active activities are also really important, because they're growing and their bone growth is actually disproportionate to their muscle and tendon and ligament growth. And so they have a lot of pulling and tugging within their bodies, and that's what gives them things like growing pains, and so they're uncomfortable. We know that, for example, their tailbone is actually starting to harden, and so that's uncomfortable for them. And so getting up and moving, there's actually a biological underpinning in terms of why that's important, because they're restless and they have this because of the great growth that they're going through. We also know too that when they're going through that physical development, that boys and girls reach that growth spurt at different stages. So girls reach it a little bit earlier than boys, probably about 13, and boys is about 14 and a half. And so quite often in year 7 you'll find that a lot of your girls will be taller than your boys, but within a year or two you'll find that that will be reversed. And what's quite fun is if you have a look at their feet actually grow before they have a growth spurt, and so quite often their feet can be quite disproportionately large to the rest of their body. And we also know that their body grows, different parts of your body grows in different at different rates. So from birth, your head actually doubles in size, your trunk grows 3 times, your arms grow 4 times, and your legs grow 5 times. So if you can imagine having these growth spurts during puberty, that and your legs are suddenly growing that little bit more quickly than other parts of your body, you can imagine that kids who have a lot of self-esteem tied around being good at sport or being good at different activities, all of a sudden they're not able to do it as well, because they, you know, if they're a long jumper, for example, and they've just gone through a growth spurt, their stride is different. If they're a basketballer, all of a sudden their push is different. You know, tennis, all of a sudden the sweet spot on the tennis racket isn't quite where they thought the reach used to be. And so you need to be explaining these things to them so that they can actually understand, and that sense of self-esteem in terms of their identity around being good at things isn't actually thrown out. So it's just keep practicing, you'll get better at it again, because you just need to learn where your body's at again. We know then, we've talked about the cognitive development in terms of abstract reasoning and the brain reconfiguring. And their social and emotional growth is all about that they've got 2 main goals at this age. One is to gain a sense of independence. So they're trying, and that's actually a little bit counterintuitive in terms of the age that they are, because they're still very reliant on parents for, you know, a lot of the physical things that they need in life. And yet they're wanting to make a lot of decisions for themselves. And so they're very good at starting to wanting to take on responsibility. And so we need to look for opportunities to help them develop that and develop that sense of who they are. And the other thing that they're trying to do is to develop a sense of who they are in terms of their identity formation. And you will see kids come in almost like little clones in year 7. And then over time, over the next couple of years, you'll see them try out different friendship groups and different styles and ways that they dress or ways that they speak or different music. And what they're trying to do is to find a group where they get a really strong affinity to, and where they have a really great sense of belonging. And what you can find sometimes is your little odd person who's a little bit different, a little bit quirky, will actually join with a group and you think, oh no, don't do that, that's not going to be good for you. And yet what they're trying to do is to develop a sense of identity and a sense of belonging. And so what we need to do is do some of that social skilling to help them identify where they can fit in and why they can fit in with a range of different friendship groups. So what we also know about early adolescence is it's a time when we see out their learning either slow down, stop, or even go backwards. And it depends on what you do in the classroom as a teacher, because we know that teachers are key in terms of making the most difference to a student's learning. Hattie puts it at about 30% of the overall in terms of what a student brings to a classroom. So about 50% is their own personality, comes with their IQ and, you know, who they are as a person. Small amounts then come from the school, the principal, parents, home support, all those things. But about 30% can be attributed to the teacher. We've also just had recent studies that have talked from the Grattan Institute that have come out and said, if you get a really effective teacher who's really cognizant of the developmental stages of these young people and works effectively with them in that year, you can actually advance them really well in that year. If you get a teacher that's not as much considering their developmental characteristics, they will only advance them half of that. And what happens is after that year, that gap then extrapolates out. So those who have done really well will keep accelerating and doing really well, and those who haven't done so well will actually be behind the eight ball continuing. And so what you're doing in a classroom is critical to the development and to the academic success of young people. So what are the causes of disengagement? And there's a lot. We can't just pinpoint it to say one thing, because when we look at dropout rates of students across the Western developed world, so, you know, UK, US, Australia, European countries, we know that the percentage of students who don't finish compulsory schooling is anything from 20 to 25%. And that's in our country. So we often will look at some of the third world countries and think, oh, look, they've got a long way to go with their education system. Well, we do too, because we're failing at least 20% of our young people because they're not finishing their compulsory schooling. And what we also know is that disengagement and that dropout is a process over time. It doesn't just happen. They don't wake up one morning after being a great student saying, had enough, I'm not going to school anymore, or I'm going to drop out. It's a process of over time of being disengaged from schooling. And so what are some of the things that happen to young people that actually start that process rolling? And one of the things that we know is a thing that we call social comparison. So when you get young children in prep, you know, up to about year three, they're excited to go to school. You ask them to run in a race and they're going to run in a race. You ask them to do a puzzle or whatever, they'll all give it a go. They're all really happy to give it a go. And they really don't care if somebody else beats them or somebody else can draw a better picture of them. They're just excited to be there. But then what we do is developmentally, we start to become aware of others around us. And we know, and I bet you all can tell me somebody who's better at something else than you are. You know, you'll know that somebody's a better artist than you, somebody can sing better than you, somebody can run faster than you, somebody can cook better than you, all these different things. And young adolescents become very attuned to that, and they actually start to put labels on themselves and to minimise what they're capable of and restrict what they will try and attempt to do, because they don't want to be perceived as being a failure. So they will do things that they know that they're good at or better at than others consistently and continually if they have a sense of efficacy around that. If they don't, they will often, and not all of them, but can say, I'm not even going to do that because I've got no chance of winning. What's the point of doing that or sitting for that that scholarship or running in that race or trying out for that team when I know that I'm not going to get in? And so they actually have quite a defeatist attitude. So that's one of the things that can actually affect students' engagement. And so what we need to do is we need to set up a culture within our classrooms so that we remove and try as much as we can that social comparison. What we're trying to do is to get each child to recognise their own development and own growth and almost treat them like Olympic athletes, where they can lose and they can come last, but if they've done their best, then they've actually succeeded. And so we get them to compare only against themselves because they're the only person that they need to beat and to be better than. And it's that sort of an attitude. We look at the onset of puberty, and that has, as we've looked at some of the differences with in terms of brain and growth, that has its own difficulties in terms of, and also being a time of transition as well. they can become very disillusioned with learning, particularly as they transition from a primary school to a secondary school. In a primary school, they often are doing big picture things, solving problems, working in an integrated curriculum, and they go to a secondary setting where their subjects are very siloed and isolated, and so they don't see the connection between what they're learning, and they see things as very overwhelming and difficult, and quite often the demands in terms of reading and academic demands jump quite a bit in secondary school as well. The other thing then that they can, we see the onset of attribution and drive theories, and so what they do is they will attribute their failure to something, to them not being smart or to the failings within themselves, rather than looking at, well, maybe I needed a bit more support in that, or maybe there was something else going. And the other thing that's becoming very more aware of at this point in time is growth mindset theory. And we know Carol Dweck has done a lot of work around that. And that's been about the last 15 to 20 years that work has really been coming out. But it's becoming a lot more popularised at the moment when we talk about positive psychology. And when a child has a growth mindset, what they're saying is that they recognise that if they try something and don't succeed, that if they put in more effort, or if they look for other ways of getting support, that they can actually improve and they can actually increase in their ability to do things. People with a fixed mindset say, I'm no good at that, I won't try, I'm not intelligent, and they see intelligence as being fixed regardless of effort. And so we need to be teaching our young people about the brain and about the fact that their brain is still very plastic and very pliable, and that when they see a challenge, just like crossing that ravine, you know, the first time you do it, it's going to be really hard. But the second time you do it, it's going to be easier and easier and easier. And it's exactly the same as growing any other muscle in the body. If you want to improve it and get it bigger, you lift bigger weights. So if you want your brain to be stronger and to be able to do more complex things, well, then you keep challenging it and you keep working and doing those sorts of things. And so there's a range of ways that students can become disengaged and become discouraged from learning. So how do you engage and motivate students in your class? So here we go. What we're going to do is we're going to do a KWL, which somebody talked about before. So in your booklet, you've got a KWL chart. So what I want you to do now is have a look at that. And in there's the list at the front, and then I've actually done a blank sheet for you, so you've got an empty one, is what do you know about student engagement? What do you know engages young adolescents? And then in the next section, put the things that you would like to know. In a classroom, this can actually be a way of setting learning goals, or students having learning goals for themselves about, you know, what they already know about a topic, what they'd like to know, and then to reflect as a reflective activity again, looking at them, analysing and reflecting on what they've done to actually complete about what they've learnt. So I'll give you about 3 or 4 minutes just to write down and to complete those first two columns so that we can work on that. So let's have a look at what you know. What do you mean by engagement? So what do you know about student engagement? What does it look like? What does it sound like? What does it feel like in your classroom? What's engagement?
Actively interacting and putting in their two bobs worth for what's being discussed.
Okay, so students are actively involved.
They're more self-directed.
Okay, more self-directed in learning, yep.
They want to do fun stuff.
They want to do fun stuff. Does that mean that we only give them fun stuff to do?
Not all the time.
Okay, great.
They want to know the relevance.
Okay, they want to know the relevance. Kathleen? Okay, so they're forced to form opinions. So what do you want to know about student engagement?
How to make topics or subjects that they aren't interested in or can't see any relevance in, how to make that engaging.
Okay, so how to...
Some, across a range of subjects that just...
Okay, yep.
I would like to know how to efficiently cater to everybody's needs.
So how to cater... For that
diversity. How to do it efficiently.
Yeah. Efficiently? Yeah, good luck. Okay, sorry, I didn't mean to be flippant, but yeah, it's tough.
I feel the same.
Okay, so if we have a look at what student engagement is, student engagement is actually a multifaceted construct that encompasses a whole range of things. It encompasses a student's sense of belonging to the classroom. It encompasses their sense of connectedness to what's happening within the lesson, so the relevance and what they see there. It also has to do with their connection to the school and to the teacher and to their peers, so really has a lot to do with their sense of belonging. But it also has to do with the way that you construct the work that they're doing. And so when we see students engaged, it is a lot of those things that you're already talking about. But when you know that students are engaged, it's where they're actually putting in a lot of effort into something that generally is beyond what you're expecting them to do. And it's almost that you've got to chase them out at lunchtime with a broom, because they really just are so engrossed and really want to keep doing and nutting out or getting to the answer and finishing what they're doing. So it's that sense of really being totally absorbed and immersed in the activity and in the learning, and being self-directed and actually, you know, looking for and going beyond. So how do we actually get that within our classrooms? So when we talk about engagement, there's a lot of difference between compliance and conformity and engagement. Because I've had teachers tell me that their students are really engaged, and I can walk in their classroom and I can see students on task, but I don't know whether I would have said that they were engaged. They were being very compliant, but whether they're engaged or not is different. And so engagement is actually a continuum. So it's not one, you know, one thing or another. There's a continuum of engagement. And at the bottom end, we have what we call rebellion. And we know what that looks like. That's pretty much anarchy in the classroom, and the kids are doing whatever, you know, misbehaving, not going to do it, totally out of control, and there's no work happening at all within the class. The next stage that we have is what we call retreatism. Now, retreatism is when we set work for students in a classroom and they will do whatever it takes to get out of it. They are the ways that they avoid. Now, I've had really bright children in my classes who are very good at retreatism, and they sucker me in, because what they do is they will ask me questions completely off topic, and it'll be something that I'm really interested in. And so next thing you know, I've spent my whole class time talking about something that I'm really interested in, and these kids are going, yes, because they've done what we call retreatism. They've avoided doing the work. They're not being rebellious. They're not acting out. I'm not going to send them out of the classroom for asking questions, but have they successfully avoided the work? Absolutely. What other sorts?
Sometimes when that happens, you can get some really excellent feedback from the kids and discussion that then can lead into the next part of that lesson that you wouldn't have either had before.
Absolutely. Absolutely, I totally agree.
So whether it was deliberate on that student's part or not, I mean, we'll never know, but I've had some very, very, very valuable feedback from the kids when I've done those sorts of things.
Yeah, and I have too, and I also know when they've been naughty. So what other sorts of things do they do to in terms of retreatism, have you seen happen? Anybody else experience that, or is it just me? Go to the toilet, get a drink, yep.
What did you do on the weekend, miss?
Yep, sharpen their pencil, can't find their book, you know, need to share, need to go and talk to somebody about something, forgot this, need to go to the office, all those sorts of things are retreatism. Okay, the next is passive, and this is where I think a lot of us mistake engagement for students on task. And this is where they're passively doing the work, but you will give them work and they will do exactly, or really, you know, how much do I have to do? And if you ask them to write a 200-word paragraph, they will write 199 words or 201 words, but they won't go well beyond that. They will do exactly what you've asked them to do, no more. And when they're finished, what do I do now? It's not looking for more. It's just, you know, done, dusted, finished. So we get that passive, which is very compliant, and we see that a lot. And a lot of times it's often busy work or different things. It's form, it's sheet filling out, it's those sorts of things. The next thing we see is what we call ritual, and so we're starting to move up a bit. And this is where you might be using group work in your classes. So you're thinking, okay, for young adolescents, it's really important that they like to work together. We'll give them a task, and they're actually quite busy on the task, and they're really, you can see that they're enjoying working together. And so you're actually getting a sense of engagement because they are working. And if you've got somebody who's a little bit more motivated within that group will actually go beyond what the set task was, and they will encourage and support each other to actually go beyond that. And so you've got that sense of moving towards authentic engagement until we get to what we call authentic engagement. And this is where students are self-directed, where they're totally immersed in what they're doing, and it's very difficult to actually get them to stop working rather than getting them to start working because they're totally absorbed in that. And so if you have a look at that continuum in terms of that and think about your classroom, think about what types, you know, where on the continuum are my students most of the time? Because there will be times when they will be passive, where they will have tasks where they just need to either follow instructions and copy stuff down or practice stuff that they're not really going to say, well, you know, I want another 50 of those, but they're actually just going to do it. And so thinking about how we can actually move towards the top end of that continuum more often within our classrooms. Okay, so what I want you to do now is you were going to do a PMI. So now this can be an activity that you can do around making judgments and decisions. And so you can have it, P is for pluses, M is for minuses, and I can either be for interesting facts or for improvements. And so what I want you to think about is think about a lesson that you've taught in the last week where you think that students were really engaged. So what were the pluses about that lesson in terms of your organisation, in terms of your structuring? What were the things that were really positive about that lesson that meant that you were actually catering to those students and facilitating engagement? What were some of the things that you think, well, maybe that didn't work so well, or maybe, and there might not be any minuses in that, you might have thought it was a great lesson and we'd love to hear about it. And were there any interesting facts or are there any improvements? So just a reflective activity. So think, and I'll give you about 2 minutes to think about it. So what I want you to do is consider one class lesson that you've done in the last 2 weeks of term and think about where you really feel that students were engaged. And I'd like a few people to talk to me, to share. So tell me the subject, the content. So if you're a maths and you were doing, you know, whatever it was in maths, and what the activity was and how you could tell that students were engaged. So who can tell me a lesson, who'd like to share a lesson that they've done in the last 2 weeks where they felt that they've been really had students engaged?
Mine was a Year 9 business class. We were looking at the law, and I put up a cartoon of society with, like, everything was chaotic, there was no laws, and I got them to just write down all the different laws that were being broken. And I thought it wouldn't go as well as it did, but all the kids really, well, most of them got really involved and were asking questions. And they even, it even became a competition between them about who would have the most and those types of things.
So why do you think it was engaging?
I don't know, I think because the cartoon was just something, it was a fun sort of cartoon.
So we got a sense of fun?
Yeah, we hadn't done something like that before with them. You know, it's a completely new topic that they're interested
in. So a new topic, it was something that they were interested in. Could they see relevance to it?
Yeah.
There was a connectedness to their life, so we could see those sorts of things. Great example. Somebody else?
We're doing G20 with the grade 12s at the moment for tourism. Current local issues affecting tourism. And we've already given them all of their background knowledge, and they've got to do a test coming up. So to test and clarify the background knowledge, we actually did like a sale of the century scenario. And none of them wanted to stand up. So we got them all to stand up, and every time somebody answered a question correctly that was relevant to the information, they got to sit down. And we knew that everybody was getting engaged because everybody else was yelling out everybody's answers for questions that had nothing to do with them. And then they wanted to do it again, and again, and again, and again. And it ended up being an entire class of just a whole bunch of questions, and they all knew the answers.
All reviewing, so great. So fun activity, so collaboratively learning. So great example. I'm seeing some common things here. I'm seeing collaborative learning. I'm seeing relevance, so linking what's happening to them. I'm seeing fun, and I'm seeing students actually taking ownership and actually being engaged and rolling the lesson along. Okay, so what I want to do now is just go through four research supported methods to engage students. And the first one that we talk about is lively teaching, which promotes success. Now, lively teaching is a lot of the things that you've just talked about. So it's group work, using games. It's it emphasises students constructing knowledge. It's not always teacher and not necessarily teacher directed. And it's social and it's fun. And from the examples that we saw, you could just about use that as a checklist, because that's exactly what they did. The thing though that you need to put, and I'll put a caveat on it, is what you need to be aware of is that students really need to feel success. It helps them to develop a sense of esteem, self-esteem, and that sense of competence as a learner. But the thing that you need to be very mindful of is that you give them opportunities to experience success, but success shouldn't always be the overriding factor, because the really creative people are very often not successful, because creativity often means that you have failures. And so if you want somebody to be really creative, then you have to help and develop that mindset that, you know, that's okay, and look for ways of helping them to experience success, but balancing that with them being creative. And one of the examples that I use is WD-40. Does everybody know what WD-40 is? Okay. Does everybody know what WD-40 stands for? Where they got the name from? Okay. WD is water displacement, because that's what it does. And 40 is because it was the 40th attempt at the formula. So if they had given up on try one or try two or try 25, attempt 25, we probably wouldn't have that great stuff that loosens everything that we need it to. So making sure that we have a balance between success and creativity. Okay. The other thing is that academic rigor or curiosity. And so what we need to do is be providing students with challenging work that actually gives them that sense of achievement, because what we know is if we make work too easy for them, that they become quite complacent and there's not that sense of, wow, I could really do that. And it needs to be able to stimulate their curiosity. And there's a range of things that we can do. And that was in response to, there was a question earlier about, you know, how do we actually get students to be engaged in topics in any subject? And what we need to do is we actually need to find some point in the topic that actually is going to engage and create a sense of mystery or curiosity. And quite often the things that students get really engaged in are things that are quite unconnected, in terms of like the information doesn't seem to be quite fluid. And you know, if a child comes to you and is really excited, or somebody comes to you and is really excited about telling you an event, they will tell you the punchline generally first and say, you know, guess what happened, he got hit in the face with a pie. They don't start off and start saying, you know, he was walking down the street, or he got dressed, and da 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 da, and building up to it. And it's the same with students. They'll come up to us and they'll tell us the big picture stuff first, and then they walk through it. And what we often do in classes is we think, well, they need to know this stuff that walks through the park first. And by the time we get to the punchline, the kids are really bored and they're over it and don't want to do it. So what we do is we create a sense of mystery around it and curiosity. One thing that I used to love teaching with my Year 7s was conspiracy theories. They used to love looking at that and trying to solve those puzzles. And are any maths teachers in here? Google a fellow called Dan Meyer. Yeah, he teaches for does a thing about teaching for perplexity, and he will actually create a problem, not give them all the information, and make them actually find out the information and work, and not just finding the information, but actually piecing bits of information together. Because if you pose a question or a task and the student can Google it and get the answer straight away, you need to rewrite your task, because Google is very intuitive, and it needs to be something that they actually have to go and be piecing things together. So looking at making topics more complex, so they actually have to nut it out, and there's a sense of achievement as they do that. And in terms of challenge, if we have a look at this instructional challenge, if we have very low skills, or the task requires very low skills and very low challenge, the students are very likely to feel quite apathetic about doing it. You know, there's no challenge, they don't need to do any, you know, use it, they don't need any skills to do it, and so what's the point? They really don't see a point in doing it. If we have a set a task where there's an expectation that it's very high challenge, but they've got either a low skill set or, you know, they don't know what to do, they can feel highly anxious about that. And so what we're doing is we're actually creating a point where we're actually creating a barrier to learning, because what we also know about the brain is that if our brains get really anxious and really stressed, that they actually don't function very well. And that's why it's really important that we actually scaffold and support and give opportunities for students to develop those skills along the way, because if we just try and push them straight away to doing something that they can't do, they'll actually put up this block and not be able to do it. Has anybody ever been put on the spot to do something and thought, I can't do it? Exactly why is your brain actually starts to shut down, or, you know, starts to close down a bit because it's stressed. So stress doesn't do great things for our learning. The other thing is if it's low challenge but high skills, they think, oh, this is too easy, I can do this, and so they're really not interested in actually trying to pursue that and do that, because again, it's too easy. What we're looking for is a high challenge that requires high skills, and we're also looking to tap into Vygotsky's zone of proximal development. So we're actually getting them to either work collaboratively or with sufficient teacher support so that they get to a point where they can actually do things that were just a little bit beyond their capability on their own. So it's a high challenge but high skills, and they get that sense of achievement that they've actually achieved something that's really worthwhile. So the next and number three in terms of our strategies is connective instruction. And we've talked a lot about this. It's where you build relationships with students. It's where you create relationships between what you're teaching to the students and their lives, both at their lives in school at this point in time, to the community outside of school, or to their future careers. So if they can see a connection in any of those areas, their sense of engagement will be increased. And that has become very evident in the examples that have been coming through. And the final one is relationships. The thing that I think a lot of teachers really need to recognise is that there is nothing more loyal than a year nine class that you have a strong relationship with. If you can bond with those kids in that class, they will fight for you to the death, because they are very tribal and they are very loyal. And what you need to do is to look at ways of building those relationships so that you actually get that sense, because you can actually go into a classroom and be not feeling great and say, guys, I'm not feeling great today, be kind. And they will be. They'll be very supportive. But if you haven't got a good relationship with those kids and you go into a year nine class and you say, guys, I'm not really feeling well today, it's on. So be aware of that. So you need to be providing affirmations for students, so praise, and it needs to be process praise. So, you know, not that you're a good boy or good girl, it's I really like the way that you persisted in that. So something that can be repeated, so looking for that process praise, and giving them written feedback and opportunities for success, and using humour. Show them that you care about them, that you understand them, and that you're actually human, and that you actually have a personality. And most people that teach in junior secondary, in my experience, are normally a little bit naughty and a little bit cheeky themselves, and that's why they're able to relate well with young adolescents. And so if we have a look now at the engagement dimensions, and you've got all these notes because I've put these notes in that package for you, we have a look at engagement. Three dimensions: there's behavioural, there's emotional, and there's cognitive. And we've got a list there of the things that we can see in terms of, if I was to look at your class and think about cognitively, if my students were engaged in that classroom, I would see them participating. I would see them actively engaged. I would see a sense of presence in the classroom. They're there because they want to be there. They're not there just because they're a warm body in the room, and if they aren't there, they're going to get a detention. So they're there. They're on task. Their behaviour is appropriate to the setting and to what's happening within the classroom. They're being compliant with the rules. So doesn't matter what the rules are. If they're engaged, they will live with that. They'll work through that. And we can see that effort, that persistence, that total engagement in what's happening within the classroom. Emotionally, we'll see them having a positive relationship with both you as a teacher and with their peers. So if they're engaged in something, a lot of times you'll see any differences within personalities actually dissipate within the classroom, because they are more interested in getting the job done and working and resolving issues or solving a problem than they are about the spats that are happening in the classroom. They will see the value in what they're learning, and they also will see, have an interest in what's happening. And you'll see them emotionally having that relationship and that to their peers, to you, and that sense of belonging to school. And then cognitively, they'll be learning by choice. So they're actually going beyond, and you'll see they're going beyond what you would normally expect what the criteria says. You know, this is what an A looks like. You know, they're trying to extend past that. They're wanting to put in that effort, that self-regulation, where they're actually monitoring themselves. They're using those metacognitive strategies. So they're starting to actually self regulate in terms of, you know, wow, I did that, but I could have done that better because of that. So they're actually starting to reflect on those things. And having students in classes have a learning journal where they can actually use that thing like that two questions activity that I gave you and use that as a strategy that you use continually as a learning journal is a good way of helping students to engage in that type of reflective activity. And it's also important for you as a teacher to be modelling those types of activities and to talk them through. You know, I think today went really well because, or I did this really well, or this, I could have improved this by doing this, and talking through those reflective activities yourself, because it models it really nicely for students. And we see them then having a preference for a challenge. So they're not worried about failure so much. They're more interested in actually being challenged and enjoying the activity rather than being concerned about failing. And there's a sense of urgency and also a sense of, I really want to get this, I really want to nail this and get this done and get this right and be good at it. Okay, so the last activity that we're going to do is an activity where, and I couldn't remember the name of the game show, and I asked my husband and he couldn't remember either, and he normally remembers everything, so I was a bit disappointed. There was used to be a game show where they would give you the answer and you had to come up with a question. Thank you. There you go. Okay, so question key is like Jeopardy, but what you've got to ask students to do is to come up with five questions with the same answer. So if I gave you, and the example I've got on the sheet there is the sun, that's the answer. So I can use this as a revision. I can use it to try and elicit information out of students. So if the answer is the sun, what's the question?
The star at the centre of our solar system.
The star at the centre of our solar system. So it's a sun. What else? Read another one. There you go, the only star in us. I didn't have that one down. Well done. But you get the idea of that. It's a great way of doing a revision for students rather than you saying, you know, asking a question and getting one student to give you an answer, because all of a sudden they've got to start giving you lots of different different responses in terms of thinking about it, and they've got to have a really solid knowledge of the content to be able to phrase a question to get that answer. So it's a nice tool for that. Okay, so for you as teachers, the role that you need to ask yourself is, do I deliver interactive, varied and relevant lessons? Am I encouraging and supportive to students? Do I have classrooms in which students feel comfortable asking questions? So is there a sense of that risk taking in there, and that any question is acceptable, so there's no such thing as a stupid question? So there's that sense of, you know, it's okay to ask questions. Where students are expected to do their best, so really high expectations for all students, regardless of what level that they're at. Where instruction is challenging and where specific feedback is given to help students with their current learning. Are my lessons paced with varied learning tasks? So is there a variety of tasks that I'm using? So I'm not sort of mapping out. I remember one of my prac teachers actually, who pulled out overhead transparencies, and she said, these are great. She said, I've been using them for the last 19 years and they've worked really well every year. I thought, you know, are we using and updating and looking at ways of improving our activities? Are we doing different things now rather than just getting students to take notes? It would be interesting for you to go back to your schools now and take your mind map and start to talk to somebody else about the adolescent brain. Because I know that if you had just sat there passively listening to me, in 3 days' time, you'd probably only be able to remember about 10 to 20% of what I talked about. With notes and with doing something actively with that, the chances are that you'll probably remember anything from about 65 to 70% of what we've talked about today. And so note-taking, and when you're organising your notes in a way that's meaningful for you, is really, really important. Do I deliver a relevant curriculum? So making those connections, and we've talked about that quite a lot. And do I encourage students to set goals? And we looked at that, even that KWL chart looks at you know, setting goals and having individual learning plans and those sorts of things, where students are constantly being challenged to improve themselves so that they, we try and avoid that social comparison where they're comparing with other students, but they're actually helping and looking at improving themselves and moving forward. Yeah, there we go. So, any questions?